cruise ship riddled with COVID has this morning docked in Sydney.
We understand around 800 people on board are infected. Health officials and crew told to wear full PPE. Let's bring an infectious disease expert at the University of Sydney, Professor Robert Boy. Good morning, Professor. So infected guests are disembarking separately to those who test negative. They've been isolating in their cabins. But, you know, it takes you back to 2020, doesn't it, to Ruby Princess, and this is the sister ship. So how do we control the spread?
Well, yes, it does feel a little bit frightening, but we've got a lot more protection in place now. But controlling the spread, it goes back to what you should be doing, some social distancing, wearing a mask indoors. What you can also do is, if you're positive, consult your GP as soon as you can to see if you're up for an antiviral. Most people now have got immunity from both infection and from vaccination, and the combination is called a hybrid. It's really quite strong, but for those people who are older and vulnerable with multiple medical problems, they can get treatment early if they're already positive.
So, Professor, as Belinda said, we've seen some passengers isolating in their cabins on board this vessel, but there are no isolation rules. This is living with COVID, isn't it? These passengers, when they step off this boat this morning, they're free to do whatever they like. How quickly do you think this could get out of hand?
Well, they'll go home and they'll start isolating in their own homes, because most people are very sensible. If you're going on a cruise, you remember you've got risk factors and you're at real risk of catching COVID. Look, cruises are a melting pot of mixing people in crowded conditions, and so we expect to see many cases. But what you have to do is respond quickly and effectively. And even if you had a booster vaccine now, if you haven't got disease, that is, you can get protection in 7 to 10 days. And there's a lifeguard on the beach. If you've been dumped by the new wave, you can be rescued by a lifeguard by seeing a GP and getting an antiviral.
So that's your advice this morning. I mean, we're seeing case numbers rising. Everyone is a little bit concerned in the lead up to Christmas. You know, we definitely don't want to be in lockdown again. So the advice is to either go and get a booster, and if you do end up with COVID, get that antiviral as quick as you can.
Talk to your GP as to whether you're eligible. People over 70 are immediately, people over 50 with two risk factors, and people over 30 who are Indigenous. So there's a large swathe of the population who go on cruises who could be eligible for a treatment which can stop the virus in its tracks. It's not perfect, but it's a great addition to the protection you get from other measures.
Professor, just quickly, crystal ball-wise, looking ahead to Christmas, this is what everyone seems to be worried about. If we're having outbreaks and we're seeing figures rise at the moment, where do you see this landing come Christmas?
This is looking, again, like previous Omicron sub-variants, a rapid rise and then a rapid fall-off as well. So it could have peaked already by Christmas. People can go ahead with their Christmas do's, but I would recommend the simple measures of a shorter do with fewer people. Do it outside rather than inside. Wear a mask if you go inside. Make sure the ventilation inside is as good as possible with windows open. So there's lots of simple, practical things that people can do and still have fun at Christmas.
A fourth COVID wave has hit Australia with a spike in case numbers across multiple states, raising concerns from health authorities. This as a new report revealed the true state of the nation's hospital crisis in the run-up to Christmas. To discuss, we're now joined by emergency physician Dr. Stephen Parnas in Melbourne. Good morning, Doctor. Let's start in Queensland. Premier Anastasia Palaszczuk is calling on people to be alert, not alarmed. Do you share that view?
Yes, I do. I think it's not just Queensland, it's the entire nation that needs to know that numbers are climbing and more people are getting sick, and there are a lot of things that need to be done to reduce the risk of getting seriously unwell.
The reality is that, you know, a majority of Australians don't really want to think about COVID anymore. A bit of PTSD, really, especially in the lead up to Christmas when these things often blow out. Are these new subvariants more dangerous?
Well, that we don't know yet. The experience from the Northern Hemisphere tells us that, as with other waves of COVID, a proportion of those who get sick will end up in hospital and a proportion will die. And it's understandable that after almost 3 years of continual change and restriction and trauma, people don't want to think about the infection, but unless they do, they're going to get hit harder by this. So It's about taking those simple precautions that make a difference to not only yourself but to those around you, those you work with and those you love.
So what does this mean for Christmas? It's, you know, 43 days until it's here. So when is the peak of this, you know, this latest wave expected to hit?
It's likely to be December, and we don't know whether it'll be a little earlier given that the control measures that we've had in place before are no longer there. But I would say sometime in December, and the question is whether that earlier peak means an earlier dissipation. But it will affect our summer plans, there's no doubt about that.
And what do you think we should be doing? Everyone just needs to, you know, get that extra booster. You know, certainly wanted to do everything to avoid any further lockdowns.
Yes, simple measures. Go for fresh air where you can. If you cannot keep a safe distance or are in crowds indoors, wear a mask and wear a good one. It does make a difference. If you haven't got your vaccinations up to date, get those vaccinations. And that should be a straightforward proposition. If you do become unwell, then get a test and isolate until you're better. And if you are unwell with COVID, then a number of people are eligible for antivirals. And if you get onto those earlier, that does make a big difference between your risk of getting seriously ill or just having a minor illness. Those things all make a difference. And if we practiced all of those, that would reduce the impact on individuals, the health system, and make life a lot easier over the next few weeks.
You mentioned the health system there, and I want to ask you about a new report this week revealing the true extent of our hospital crisis. You know, it really painted a bleak picture. Record numbers of presentations, enormous blowouts in emergency times, and dangerously low staffing. It's a major concern.
Oh, absolutely. These figures that were put together by the College of Emergency Medicine, my college, really show deterioration across all of the important markers in the provision of emergency care. The important thing to say is that these trends were happening long before COVID. So we can't just blame the pandemic and say it's all going to go away by itself. It points to the fact that our health system is not resourced adequately for the demands and expectations we as a community place on it.
Yeah, it's certainly worrying. And this all comes as the health war between the two major parties in Victoria heats up ahead of the state election. Just wanted to check what you make of the pledges from each side. You know, Labor promising a $2,500 bonus for graduate nurses and midwives, and they get another bonus after staying in the job for 2 years. And then the Liberal leader, Matthew Guy, you know, pledging additional surgery robots in public hospitals. So what are your thoughts?
Yeah, I'm pleased that health is the number one priority for the election. I'm always concerned that the state government, which only has part of health responsibility, can't do it without Commonwealth support, and that's where funding arrangements matter. But little isolated announcements in empty paddocks don't really make a difference. Attention to workforce makes a huge difference. And what I think all doctors, nurses and other experts in health would like to see is that these are announcements that are part of a wider plan. Little piecemeal efforts don't cut it, and they don't make a difference even in the medium term. So attention to health, but let's have some more organised plan based on evidence rather than opinion polls.